Since my office has a single slope roof, the front wall is taller than the back wall, meaning that the side walls have an angle in the top. Now, as far as I know, there are two ways to build a wall with an angle in the top, and so logically I chose the worse option of the two. I'll describe the better way later. I opted to build these walls all as one unit, with the stud at the back being 8 feet tall, the stud at the front being 10 feet tall, and all of the studs having an angle cut into the top that matches the slope of the roof. I'll put in the description how I found the slope of the roof, but I did use it here along with a little bit of trig to mark where the tops of the studs should be. Getting the four outside pieces in place and nailed together allowed me to easily measure the length of each stud and get them cut down to size. I simply made a measurement from the back edge of the mark on my bottom plate to the back edge of the mark on my top plate, and then cut a board with the slope of the roof, which was 11 degrees in the top. After repeating that process several times, it was time to nail all of the studs in place. What I'm doing here is called crowning. I'll talk more about that when I'm framing the front and back walls. Next, it was time to get the jack studs in place, which is what you call these shorter studs that support the framing above a window and door opening. The studs next to them that do go all the way to the top are called king studs. Now we need a header. For a 2x4 wall, this is made by sandwiching a sheet of half-inch OSB in between two pieces of 2x lumber. Your local building codes will tell you what size of 2x lumber you need based on the size of your window or door opening. The header is a structural part of load-bearing walls that will catch the load from above, pass it around your windows or doors, and down to the floor structure. These little guys are called cripple studs. Their main function is to continue the 16-inch on-center spacing of the other studs. That way, when I'm putting in my OSB sheathing and much later my drywall, I have nice and evenly spaced places to secure them. Here I am snapping a chalk line 3.5 inches from the edge of the floor structure. That way I can push the wall up to that line, and then when I stand it up, it'll fall right into place. I made a mark 8 feet up on the taller side of the wall. That way I can make diagonal measurements and compare them to each other. And if they're the same, then the wall is square. If the wall is out of square when you put the sheathing on, then it's going to be permanently out of square. I set my sheathing to overhang the bottom plate by about 8 inches. That way when I stand the wall up, it'll cover both the subfloor and the joists. OSB sheathing needs an 1/8 inch gap on all sides so that the sheets can expand and contract. So for this first wall, I would tap in 2 nails to make sure I got the spacing right. Using a router with a flush trim bit made cutting out the openings for the windows simple. since this sheet was overhanging the top of the wall, I used a 2x4 as a guide to make sure I got my nails into the top plate. In retrospect, a chalk line would have been a lot easier. I mentioned earlier that there's a better way to frame these angled walls, so let's talk about it. The better way to do this, instead of building it with the angle already in the top, would have been to frame a wall that is 8 feet tall all the way across, stand it up, frame the front wall, back wall, stand them up, go ahead and frame out the roof, and then, after the roof is framed out, come back and frame in the triangular hole that would be above the wall. There are two reasons I say that's the better choice. First, I think it would have been easier, and second, and more importantly, having a flat surface on the side walls would have allowed me to overlap their top plates with the top plate of the back wall, run screws through them, and thus tie the walls together better. Live and learn. I'll do it that way next time. Once the wall was lined up with my chalk line, I tapped two nails in on the inside of the framing, not the outside. And what these did is they held the bottom in place while I was squaring the wall, and they also served as a pivot point later when standing the wall. This wall was slightly out of square, so I had to push it into square, and then when it was there, tap nails in on the top outside of the framing to hold it in place for the sheathing. Once the sheathing's on, those nails can come back out. I put the sheathing on the walls while they were laying down because that was a lot easier for me to do by myself than trying to do it while they're standing up. The downside is it makes them a lot heavier for lifting. I didn't get any video of it, but huge shout out to my friend Steven for helping me lift these two walls. In the next video in this series, we're going to continue framing and talk about some things I didn't get to here, like crowning studs and when to double up on jack studs and king studs. So, thank you for watching, and I'll see you there.